The story of the Bee Gees is one of the most unusual in the history of pop music. Barry, Robin, and Morris Gibb have written more hit songs, sold more records, and achieved greater heights than almost anyone else in rock and roll. They have been counted out and come back again and again. And yet the Bee Gees have never been given a free ride. They are, as Barry Gibb said, the enigma with the stigma. They have been loved passionately and forgotten, celebrated and reviled, won every honor and then seen their records publicly burned. Yet the Bee Gees have outlasted all of their detractors. On the surface, the Gibb brothers seem like three of the most easygoing guys in the world, but no one in pop music has ever been more driven. The Bee Gees are legends. This is their story. During World War II, Hugh Gibb was a drummer and bandleader in ballrooms around Manchester, England. One night he spotted Barbara pass from the bandstand and asked her to dance. Hugh married Barbara in May of 1944. A daughter, Leslie, was born the next year, and the family set off on what would become a lifetime of traveling. The Gibbs moved wherever Hugh was able to find work for his band. When they were offered a steady job at a resort hotel, the Gibbs settled on the Isle of Man. Barry Gibb was born on the island on September 1, 1946. 3 years later, twin boys Robin and Morris arrived. No one knew it then, but the Bee Gees had begun. The Gibbs moved back to Manchester in 1955. The three brothers were surrounded by the sounds of their older sisters' rock and roll records.
It was in one of the empty rooms at our house when we were little kids, and we were kind of imitating a record we'd heard on the radio, that we fell naturally into harmony because we were never taught music. It's just something that was in us to begin with.
Barry got a guitar for Christmas when he was 9. The brothers started an act, miming to their favorite pop records.
We went to the movie house where they were in between the serial and the main movie. These kids used to get up and mime to pop records like Elvis and things, and we loved to do that. But we went to this theater and the record broke that we were going to mime to, so the man put the microphone in front of us and said, "We'll just sing." Lollipop,
my lollipop. Music wasn't their only hobby. Barry and Robin had become rowdy young boys.
Well, you know, if you see the Who's film, is it Quadrophenia? And it's all black and white and it's in the 50s. Well, that was the kind of existence that Manchester was like when we were little kids. And we were on the street until midnight, you know. And in the summers in England, it doesn't go dark till about 11 o'clock at night, so kids always ran free. And we had a fantastic time. But the trouble was, we were always getting in trouble with the police. And when I remember getting 2 years probation when I was about 11 years old.
By 1958, the popularity of big bands had faded, and Hugh was having trouble finding work. With the addition of a new baby, Andy, he had 7 mouths to feed. The family looked to Australia for a new start.
You could take your family for about £10 a head. Children travel free, and you sail for 5 weeks, and you start a new life in this country called Australia. And it was amazing leaving something behind, not knowing if you'd ever see it again, and it was amazing not actually knowing where you were going. So there was an adventure in that.
In Australia, Hugh found work as a photographer in the bush country. Barry, Robin, and Morris began performing at a racetrack in Brisbane, calling themselves Wee Johnny Hayes and the Blue Cats. Local DJ Bill Gates was impressed with the boys and began making tapes of them to broadcast on his radio show. He christened the group the Bee Gees. In 1960, the 14-year-old Barry and 11-year-olds Morris and Robin made their first local TV appearance. Soon the Bee Gees were performing on the vaudeville and nightclub circuit. The Bee Gees were now supporting the Gibb family. By 1961, Hugh Gibb gave up his photography job to handle his son's career.
He was our guardian. He looked after us. He took us to all the shows that we would not have been able to do because we were too young.
Our dad was a very typical northern Manchester father, and the kind that never really showed their feelings. You know, they're very, very sort of, you know, they never say call you son or anything like that, but they love you, but they don't You know, my father used to always say to us after a show, if we did a really good show and we go, wow, that was great. What do you think, Dad? And he'd go, great audience, weren't they?
We were all just looking after each other, yeah. Everybody had a positive role to play. Mum would look after the clothes. Dad would do the ironing. No, I'm joking. Dad would drive the car, take us to the shows, and we would do the shows, and the money went to support the whole family. Come on
in. The Bee Gees performed a program of songs by their father's favorites, the Mills Brothers, along with comedy routines and novelty songs. All aboard the While the Gibbs were singing standards, Barry Gibb was writing his own songs. In 1962, the brothers were signed to Festival Records, a local label. Their first single, The Battle of the Blue and Gray, was written by Barry. It didn't do very well. Many hearts are broken and a lot of tears are shed. The sky was black and the battlefield was red. By 1963, all three brothers had dropped out of school to focus on their music. They continued to release singles, and the singles continued to fail.
I think we made about seven to 11 singles that all flopped in a row. So we really found out what failure was all about before we even started. So they just didn't seem to be, it just seemed to be a track record. This is really good. I wonder how many flops in a row we can actually get, you know.
In 1964, pop music was drastically changed by the Beatles. Barry, Robin, and Morris were deeply affected.
When the Beatles came along, they were writers. It was the first group that was writing and making records, and they were doing everything that we wanted to do and always thought about doing. But we were very young, even when the Beatles came along, to be able to exercise that kind of ambition.
At a time when teenagers were taking over pop music, the Bee Gees were still performing to nightclub audiences of grown-ups. Why and women song
will only make me sad. It was a kind of kids working to adult type of things, but we were still too young to be accepted by teenagers even at that point.
At the end of 1966, the brothers decided it was time to go home to England and try to invade the British pop scene. Letters were sent to London managers, and even though they had no firm offers, the Gibb family made preparations for their long ocean voyage.
Dad wasn't very keen on coming back to England because he remembered how cold it was. And we were reaching that age where we wanted to leave the nest anyway. There was a sense of wanting to leave home even though you didn't want to leave home.
Just as the Bee Gees were about to set sail, their last festival single, Spicks and Specks, began to climb the Australian charts. By the time the Gibbs boarded their ship for England, they had the number one record in Australia. They never looked back. Oh, where are the girls I left far behind? The Spicks and the Specks
of the girls on my mind. We wanted to be part of that world of the Beatles and the Mersey Boom and because I think that's where we would get appreciated. You know, because we went as far as we could really go in Australia.
We were driven. We were kids. We knew no fear, you know. we had to go. We had to be part of that thing in London.
The Bee Gees arrived in England on February 7th, 1967. A few weeks later, they scored an audition with music mogul Robert Stigwood.
When we arrived in London, we were flat broke, and we remember that we'd sent some tapes 3 months before we left. Somehow we had a telephone call 4 weeks after we arrived in England, 3 weeks perhaps, and which was quite fortunate because, you know, we were hungry. And this phone call said there's a Mr. Stigwood on the line and he was really interested in signing us.
Stigwood liked what he heard. He signed the Gibbs to a 5-year contract. The Bee Gees were about to become part of the British pop scene they had fantasized about from the other side of the world. Now I can see nobody. My